Hi everyone, how are you all doing? Sending lots of love to all of you. I thought I'd drop in and say hi. I just did a Facebook Live on Mike Dooley's group page, which is called Raise the Vibe. I highly recommend you check it out and check out the video, but I think we've shared it across to my page, so it's probably a post below this one. Please check that out because I've been speaking about the uncertain times that we're going through and why it's really important for us to reach for love right now. And it's important not to stay silent, but in not staying silent, it's really not about spreading fear or spreading awareness or spreading anger. It's about spreading love. And that is more important than anything right now, because the fear and the anger is the opposite of love. And so remember, fill yourself up with love wherever you go, because if you feel fearful and angry, that's what you're taking with you wherever you go. And right now, the world needs love more than ever before. And for more information on what I just said, please check out the previous video. Please check it out. So I would love to take some questions from you. I'm sending you love vibes. Go ahead, Milena, any questions? And you can feel free to ask me about anything at all. And
we have a question from Maria asking about your insights about the eclipse energy.
Of course, the eclipse energy. I forgot to even mention that. So I think the eclipse is going to be, the energy is always, of course, very different and very cleansing. I think tomorrow, it's particularly in this part of the world, I actually feel this part of the world, America right now probably needs it the most, because because it seems that whatever America does, whatever the government of America does, it gets reverberated throughout the whole world. For me, eclipse energy is a very cleansing energy, and it also brings things up to the surface. It brings everything up to the surface to be cleansed and also to be healed, and that's what we're seeing going on right now. And we'll probably see things maybe looking like they're getting worse before they get better. That's, unfortunately, things will seem like they're getting worse. But remember, sometimes even when you're taking medication for an illness, you always feel worse before you get better, because it's bringing the illness up to the surface so that it can be cleansed out of your system. And that's kind of what's going on right now as well.
Maeve asks what your advice would be to someone who fears death.
So for someone who fears death, what it usually means when you fear death, it means that you don't have enough going on in your life right now. Like you don't have enough passion in your life right now and enough to keep you interested in life. People who are highly focused on death are not focused on life. So what I would suggest is to really help this person to figure out a reason to live or a will to live, to help them to figure out things like, what are they passionate about? What are their reasons, or what would make them feel like they're following their calling? Find their calling in life. What makes them feel passionate? What is it that when they're doing it, they completely forget about the time, they even forget to eat? That is your calling, and to focus on that. So whenever people are afraid of death, it means they don't have a strong enough foothold or focus on their life. So it means it's time to focus on life.
Heidi asks if you gained psychic abilities after your NDE.
So this is about psychic abilities, and I feel I did. I feel that we're all born with psychic abilities, but we lose it or it starts to fade over. Because our society, our culture, our education system, it doesn't provide us an environment in which to foster our psychic abilities. And so we all have psychic abilities. And when we are, when the environment encourages us to suppress it or ignore it or relegates it to being our imagination, we stop trusting it and we stop listening to it. So what the NDE did for me is that it renewed my trust in my own psychic abilities. And the reason I wanted to explain it that way is because I want you all to know that you have psychic abilities. And yes, I do have psychic abilities. We all have it. We just have to learn to tune into it and hone it. And it's just unfortunate our environment is not conducive for us to do that.
Sarah asks, how can we help people be less anxious in life?
See, that's an interesting one. How can we help people be less anxious in life? I think that it takes, first of all, we have to look within ourselves. Whenever we are calm ourselves, when people are around us, they pick up on our energy. And so ask yourself, when you are around anxious people, do you start to become anxious? So if you want to be able to calm anxious people, you need to anchor your own calmness, your own inner stability. So work on yourself, and the people around you will all fall into place. They'll become calm. And I guess the next question would be, how do you become calm yourself? There are many ways. Like for me, sometimes if I feel the world is getting to me, I have to retreat and be alone. And I go out in nature, or I listen to music. For me, those are the two big things, being in nature or listening to music. And again, it's different things for different people, so I don't want to judge anything. But I really need time when I truly am alone, like really alone. Before I had the near-death experience, before I even had cancer, I used to think that the time I was alone was free time, and so if somebody wanted to spend time with me, I would slot them in during all my free time. Today, I actually schedule alone time, and it's not considered free time. That is very valuable and very important to me, because that's when I tune inward and listen to my own guidance. That's when I feel that my higher self, my angels, my guides can communicate with me. And when I get enough alone time, then I don't feel any anxiety at all. And if I don't feel anxiety, then that's what I take with me wherever I go, and that's what I spread to everyone else. So thank you for that beautiful question.
Judy asks, can you explain what it means to embrace fear and how to do it?
So to embrace fear, I would say it means, first of all, to accept that you feel fearful. When we believe that fear is bad, we then fear the fear itself. So whenever you feel fear coming up and you think, oh, fear is bad, I shouldn't have fear. Fear is going to cause all kinds of horrible things. It's going to make me spread fear. It's going to make me get ill. When you start thinking that way, you start to fear the fear. So you're actually adding to it. And then you try to suppress it. And then you don't, you don't allow yourself to express all your emotions. So embracing fear actually means embracing yourself. It means embracing who I am right now, all of me, every facet of me, every aspect of me, even the parts of me that are feeling fearful about certain things. And remember, not all fear is bad. Some fear leads you to do better in certain things. If you fear speaking on stage, it'll make you practice more and rehearse more before you get on stage. But it's the ongoing, constant, underlying fear that underlying hum that a lot of people just get used to. That's what's unhealthy. So the first thing is to acknowledge it if it's there. If you ignore it or if you judge it, that's not very helpful. So accept it if it's there. That's always the first step, acceptance. When you accept it, if you judge it, it means you're judging a part of yourself. Accept it, love yourself, and say, I love myself, even with the fear. And then the next step is that, okay, how do I transcend this fear? It's to love myself more. How do I do that? I ask myself, what do I want to see instead? What am I fearing? What am I fearing? So if you're fearing whatever it is, the state of the planet, the environment, maybe lack of finances, whatever it is you're fearing, identify it. Identify it. Don't push it away. Don't judge it. Don't fear it. Say, accept, okay, I fear this. Then ask yourself, what is the opposite of that fear? What would I rather see instead? I would rather see a better condition in the planet, better this, more money, whatever. Now start focusing on that, what you would rather see, and focus on how to increase it. So in other words, you're shifting the focus. You're changing where the flashlight is focused on. Remember I talk about the warehouse, check out my TED talk for that one, where the flashlight is focused. So you're shifting the focus of the flashlight from fear to love. But the only way you can shift the focus is to first accept that I am currently focused on fear. Don't deny it, don't suppress it, don't be afraid that you're focused on fear. Accept it, embrace it, and then say, okay, what is the opposite? And then shift the focus to the opposite.
Paul asks, when you say love yourself, is that body or soul?
So that's a great question. It's soul, but it's also body. It's body is very important, because if you really want to take care of your body, you have to love your body. I mean, I know a lot of people who actually, their souls are like, they know what they need to do, they know everything, but then their body just can't keep up with their souls. And it's like, are you two friends, your body and your soul? So you have to line them up. You have to line them up. For me, that's my biggest challenge. My soul, like, it soars every day from the moment I get up. It's like, I know what I want to do. I know where I have to be. I know I'm like full of the love that I feel is bouncing off the walls. It's bouncing off the walls. But if my physical body, if I've eaten too much or had too much chocolate, it's like, oh God, please. So we have to love our bodies if we want to line it up with our souls. And people ask me, how do you love yourself? So let me tell you the opposite of loving yourself. When you don't love yourself, what does it mean? It means I'm not worthy. I'm not deserving. It means I'm a people pleaser. I'm a doormat. Those are the symptoms of not loving yourself. It means I throw myself under the bus. It means that I give and give of myself, but I don't know how to receive. I don't know how to recharge my batteries. These are all symptoms of not loving yourself. It means having an imbalanced relationship where my partner can treat me any way they want, but I still hold on to them because I want to hold on to the relationship. All these are symptoms of lack of self-love. So self-love is the opposite. It means seeing my own worth, my own value, seeing that I am deserving. I'm deserving of love. I'm deserving of abundance. I'm deserving of working in something that makes me feel passionate. That's what self-love is. It means knowing that I have a purpose, knowing that I'm guided, knowing that I'm watched over, and that I am loved, and I don't have to work hard at being loved or at being worthy. I am loved just because I exist.
Rita Pape is asking on behalf of a mother whose child transitioned about 13 years ago, can you give advice for ways that they might feel a connection to their loved one?
Oh, that's, first of all, I want to say that my heart goes out to you, and your child is with you. Your child is guiding you all the time anyway. Your child doesn't leave you. And don't worry, a lot of people say to me that if my loved ones are guiding me, then am I taking them away from something else? You're not, because time doesn't work that way in the other realm. You're not taking them away from anything. They can be in several places at once. They can be with all their loved ones, and they can also be doing whatever they need to do in the other realm. And they can be continuing to expand. They are limitless in the other realm. I believe that when Wayne Dyer passed away, he crossed over because he knew he could reach more people from that realm than he could continue to physically reach on this realm. So your child is the same way. So I would put out intentions of looking for signs. I do that all the time, but don't put pressure on yourself. So what you can do is you can ask your child, send me a sign. And Rita, thank you for that beautiful question, because Rita is such a beautiful soul. So guide your friend to ask for signs, and then look for the signs. And it could be anything, like a coin, a white feather, or something very specific that she knew relates to the child. And then let it go. Once you ask for the sign, let it go, and it'll come.
There are several questions about meditation and saying mantras, and Jeanette asks, is it important to have a spiritual practice every day?
So that's a great question. And the spiritual practice is for you to connect to your higher and higher, your guidance system. So I want to articulate this correctly. So let me just get this right. If you are being told to have a spiritual practice and it has to be this way, and it's a certain method and a certain way, and if you don't do it this way, you're doing it wrong. And when you're actually doing it, you're caught up in the stress of getting it right, then that's not doing you any good, because it's adding to your stress. I also know a lot of people who feel they should meditate, and so they try and squeeze it in, and then it becomes a stress to try and squeeze it into their busy schedule. And then once they're done, it's like, okay, I've done it. It's one more thing ticked off my list, and then they go on to their busy schedule. So doing that, first of all, is not a should. Secondly, the methodology, whether it's chanting, whether it's meditating, whether it's a type of meditation, all of that is very, very personal. So the way I like to look at it is I like to work backwards. What is it that I'm trying to achieve? In my case, for me personally, I'm trying to achieve a clearer connection between me and my guidance system, because I believe in an inside-out view of the world as opposed to an outside-in view of the world. When I don't have that clear connection, I allow the outside world to dictate my moods and what I do. But when I have a clear connection, I allow the inside world to tell me what to do, and that's what I project outside, rather than the other way around, rather than the outside world dictating how I should feel. I prefer to have the channel come from up there. So I do everything I can to keep that connection clear. And so think of what it is that you want to do. Are you trying to create more calmness, more peace? Are you trying to be more tranquil? Are you trying to clear the connection? Ask yourself what you're trying to do, and then find a practice that works for that. And so it's not about I should meditate, I should chant, which is what I used to be. And all it did was set me up to judge myself whenever I failed and didn't achieve it or didn't do it. So all of these things work. Going out in nature works. Listening to music works. Chanting works. Meditation works, but just make sure that you're doing it for you and you're enjoying it, you're feeling and you're feeling the results. Because if you're not, if it's adding to your pressure, then you're better off not doing it. So sorry for the long-winded answer, but it was important for me to get really clear on that.
Would you like one more question?
Okay, let's do a last question.
Okay, Manon asks, do you think or feel that planet Earth is the only planet with intelligent life?
I don't think so at all. So the question, in case anyone didn't hear, do I think that planet Earth is the only planet with intelligent life? Okay, I could make a joke about intelligent life right now when we look at what's going on TV, but I will refrain from kidding about it, because it would be kind of funny if this is the best we can do in the universe. sorry, I couldn't help it, but no, I don't. And I think it would be arrogant of us to think that we are the most intelligent or the only life form when you look at the vastness of the universe that's out there. I wouldn't be surprised if we are being guided by beings from other planets who are alive on other planets and on ours as well. I wouldn't be surprised if they live among us and that they communicate with us. I wouldn't be surprised at all. Absolutely anything is possible. I don't rule any of that out, and that's a great question. And I'm glad you asked it, because it does kind of open people up to think along those lines. So thank you for that question. And I want to thank all of you for tuning in. Thank you so much. Don't forget to share love, consciously share love, consciously love people. The world needs you now. Don't be silent about love. I've noticed that right now the fearful voices are the loudest ones at the moment. We need the loving voices to be the loudest ones. We need to be role models. So open your doors, share your love, and I love you, all of you. And please check out my new website. I have loads of YouTube videos. I have a couple of Facebook discussion groups, and stay tuned. I am planning to do a weekly online show, TV show called Dying to Be Me, which is in the works and should come out in a few weeks. Can't wait for you to check it out. Love you all so much. Thank you. Bye.